All right, everyone. I'm sorry we had to cut short the ASU student panel so that you weren't able to ask questions, but luckily we have some fantastic teachers from the Department of Corrections who teach there all the time. And so if you have any types of questions that you were hoping to ask our ASU volunteers, hopefully you can kind of direct them towards them. And also, you know, there are a lot of concerns that come in with teaching there full time. You know, you don't have people coming in who are volunteer students. They're teaching students who have to be in their classes. So this raises a lot of different questions, and we're so excited that they're both here. Roberta Norales teaches in Eyman Complex, and we are so excited to have her. We've worked with her for a number of years. She's fantastic. And then Mr. Price is also a Correctional Education Program teacher, or CEPT, in the Florence Complex. And he's been teaching for about 10 years, seven of which have been in corrections, and he has taught mandatory literacy, GED, and CTE classes at the prison. So without any more ado, I will turn it over to them, and they have, I know you have questions for them, and they have some things that they would like to say, so we'll get started. Thank you.
First of all, we want to, we're really excited, both Ms. Norales and I, to be here. This doesn't work at all, does it? I don't need a microphone. I'm loud enough. Was it? Oh, all right. Just get closer like that. All right. All right, so we are very excited to be able to come and speak at this conference. First, that we are so appreciative of the ASU program that we have at both Florence and Eyman Complex. To have students come out and to teach at the prisons, it's a great opportunity for our inmates to be able to have a lot more to look forward to. And as you were able to hear from this panel, the wonderful things that come about this. A lot of these guys come from upbringings and society that the thought of higher education was never even there. And they come into an environment where you're thinking prison, you're thinking, oh my God, you know, they're not going to learn anything, they're not going to get anything from this except how to be more like what they were before they came in. And when they get back out into society, into their own homes and the places where they live, they go back right to the same environment that they were in. And the whole idea of getting a higher education is what they were talking here. I think Stephanie brought it up, and Mackenzie also reiterated it, was it gives them hope. It gives them hope for a better life, for a better opportunities, and realization that they can do more with their lives. Instead of what they were, what they've lived up to that point. So this is a great program. First of all, that's what I want to add to that. I'm not sure what other things Ms. Norales has. Do you have anything else?
No, it's just that it makes them feel like a whole person. Makes them feel like they can, like Jeremy said, can go out and just conquer the world when they get out. Just to see the smile on an inmate's face when he says, oh, Ms. Norales, I can help my daughter with her English right now. So when they come for visits. So just that joy of seeing that they have some accomplishment of self. That's what I like doing, helping them do that.
All right. Yes, please.
Yes, of course I have a question. and when you talk at ASU, in the ASU classroom, you ask if they want questions, they just look at you like.
All right.
First of all, thank you. And I wanted to tell everybody that what the volunteers give to inmates is a sense of normalcy. I felt normal. The people came in to teach the class, and I felt normal. Okay, so this is a question about the GED testing, because many people probably don't know it was privatized, and the prices went up. They used to teach GED. I mean, they still teach GED, but a long time ago, the prison paid for it, then they started charging for it. And if you can't have high schools, I know, because you age out in Arizona at 22, so that wasn't a problem. What are you doing now to get people testing for GED?
That's a great question. And I appreciate that. There is, we do still have GED classes that the students, I'm no longer going to refer them to as inmates because they're our students, okay? So from here on, I'm going to be talking about our students. So our students have the opportunity to take GED courses. There's programs on computers that they can take called GED Success, which allows them to be able to go in and complete their GED program on the computer. and then take the actual GED test. It does cost now. Taxpayers of Arizona did not see the need to give the funding for that. So it's just part of all of our social responsibility to be able to say, hey, when something comes up on the ballot, hey, if it has to do with helping out the prisons or giving more money to the Department of Corrections, they need it.
How much is it?
It's $100 for them to take. And if you think about it, it's quite a bit of money. Some of them can
35 or 10 or 20 cents
an hour,
yeah.
Right? So it does come to at a cost for them. There are a lot of guys that do want this, but we have a program that's already started in the Department of Corrections. I'm going to give a nod that I can talk about this. All right. We're all good. Okay. So we do have a program that is in the Department of Corrections. And what it is a high school program. And those students, no matter what their age, if they have completed up to, I think it's 12 credits, all right, about 12 credits of high school classes, they can go back and into the A+ program and they can complete the rest of their credits and actually get a high school diploma for free. So that is something that the Department of Corrections and the state of Arizona has seen that it was a needful thing. There's a lot of kids that they in high school, they make stupid decisions and they drop out of high school and they continue on that path and think, well, it's just something I'll never achieve. It's something that I can never get. But when they come in now, we have that opportunity to be able to say, this is still possible. You still can get a high school diploma. You still can complete this. And that's what we really try to do and focus on is that helping them get that now. And that is something that's just recently come available to them is being able to complete their high school diplomas. Yes?
I'm just curious, how many people have the opportunity to get into that high school program?
It's kind of a – how many of you guys in high school, you ever heard of credit recovery? Guys all heard of credit recovery? So if you missed too many classes or something like that, you got to go back and you got to go complete that class. It's like credit recovery. So as long as those guys have completed as up to 12 credits in high school, they can go back and do what it is. It's basically credit recovery. And they can get their high school diploma.
Is that available to like everybody on every unit, or is it at one unit to a specific group?
They are currently. We are finishing up. Florence and Eyman are actually some of the last couple of complexes that are finishing up putting in the computers into the system, into the areas. And those guys that do qualify for that, if they do qualify, they will be pulled into that program to be able to complete it. Lewis Complex, Yuma Complex, Tucson Complex, they all have this already available to these students.
Perryville.
And Perryville, yes, thank you. I'll let you answer some questions.
So can I just ask you, what if you don't have the 12 credits and you pass your mandatory 8th grade education, can you go on to get credits so you could do that, or not? You have to be limited.
Okay. You are limited. At that point, you would have to enter the GED program, and you would have to go ahead and complete your GED. Yeah. Yeah. Good questions. Keep them coming.
You ready? Okay, we're going to get started.
Oh, Jessica's going to ask.
Oh, go ahead, Jessica.
So I've had the privilege to actually teach in multi-group classrooms, which is exciting. And I know that in ASU, volunteer teachers, sometimes the treatment is a little different because we are coming in, it's once a week, and it's a different class. So as educators who are in there daily, sometimes doing the mandated classes, maybe students who are self-selected, what are some unique challenges there? How do you overcome them? And what are some rewards in that as well?
Well, thank you, Jessica, because that's kind of getting us into what we're going to really talk about today. And the first thing we'd like to do is we're going to do a comparison and a contrast of the two different yards that Jeremy and I work on. I work on a level 5 yard, and Jeremy works, what are you? He's a four or five yard, and we do have three and 4 yards. And the education level on my yard is totally different from his yard. So for students, for me, on a level 5 yard, they love coming to class. because they are locked down a good part of the time that they're in their cells. So they love coming to class. I don't have any problems with students not wanting to come to class. Matter of fact, they like to stay over the time they're supposed to. So I teach and the difference between my yard and Jeremy's. Jeremy's yard has inmates that are, teacher's aides that help him teach in his class. I have no teacher's aides because I am a level 5 ER, so I teach all day long, 2 3-hour blocks of classes that start from 7:30 to 10:30, and then we go from 12 to 3:30. And I have to be very creative with the different types of presentations that I do for my students. I do a lot of PowerPoint, just trying to find fun stuff to teach to them from where they are with my mandatory students that are 8th grade literacy students. So trying to find something that's fun for them and fun for me to teach, for example, contractions. How do I teach contractions that's fun for them and they can understand and it's not boring for them but fun for me? So there's two different levels of how we teach and how we manage the classroom. For Jeremy, it may be something different.
Do you want Florence out there?
Yep.
Yes. We're going to start with Jeremy's classroom.
There we go.
There you go.
As you can see from the slide, there are no bars. There are no chairs that people have to be in. This is a normal classroom. And that's what we do promote. And this is at a level 4 yard. Not to say that, I have a few guys that are in there for murder. And this is not something that is scary by any means. But having a class full of guys that are, a lot of them aren't really interested in learning all that much, but they know that education is important. And they know that they can get places with education. And what I was thinking about this when I was thinking about this talk is that, guys, I'm going to date myself here. And so how many of you guys ever seen that movie Stand and Deliver? All right, awesome. If you haven't, it's a good movie to go see. Now, in this movie, there's a teacher in an inner city school trying to be able to reach a lot of these kids, and he's able to reach a whole classroom full and being able to teach them calculus and being able to teach them all these wonderful things. But there's all these other kids that you see that from the school that have dropped out, that have left, that have gone. They didn't get to finish their education because of something, whether it was a family issue, whether it was a gang issue, whether it was any kind of issue that they got in trouble and they weren't able to finish their education. So a lot of the times when I'm in that classroom, and I've taught junior high before, like outside of prison, and there was a lot of kids at that level even that I knew that right after they left junior high, they dropped out of high school. And it crushes me as a teacher to think that these kids that I cared about so much, that I helped so far to get so far into their education, that they just left. And that's one of the reasons why I love teaching, and especially I love teaching in the prisons, because I get to get those kids back. I get to bring them hope again. I get to bring them to something that they didn't get a chance to, because either, like I said, either their home life caused them to leave, either the lifestyle they were living in caused them to leave. But I get those kids back. And those are the kids, or now adults, that need that help. And they need that extra light that they weren't given. And they have a second chance now. And they have a second chance in the classrooms that we teach in to be able to get that back. And I think that's one of the greatest things. And yes, some guys that I get in, you know, if we go to if we go to things like North Yard or an open yard, okay, all right, tell them what an open yard is. So an open yard, there's different levels of prison that people go to, right? And first you have a level 2 yard that is Globe and North. And these yards, guys, they live in either tents or dormitories. And they once they get up, they
not
go.
Not Sheriff Arpaio tents.
No. but they get to go out. They get to go and do recreational activities. They go do programming. And they're not locked down all day long. In fact, the only time they have to go in and be counted is like during lunchtime, dinnertime, and in the evening when they're sleeping. And that's the only time that they have to go in. Otherwise, they're out on the yard. There's no bars. There's fences only, and that's it. Whereas you know, you get a lot of guys that come down that just they still have that mentality where, you know what, I don't need education. I never really needed it on the outside. I went and gotten a trade, and I don't need this stuff. Why do I need it? And to be able to try to convince these guys that everything it requires you to be able to do this. Well, how are you going to balance your checkbook if you don't know how to do math? How are you going to be able to survive and to move on and to do just the basic things that life requires if you don't know how to write a letter? You know, and these are the things that I try to bring to them, real life experiences and examples when I struggle with them to get them to class. How are you going to do this? How are you going to write your kid? How are you going to, what happens when your kid comes to you with homework and says, "Dad, can you help me with my homework?" And you have no idea what he's talking about in the fifth grade. These are the things and the real life examples that I give to them and I throw at them and say, this is what you need to learn this for. This is why this is important, because this will help you in your life. This will help you to achieve that. Now, it's not to say that, you know, I'd love to say that I reach everyone. I don't reach everyone. We don't reach everyone. But those guys that are willing to sit down and learn, and we have other guys that are on the yard that have been in class, that have went through all the steps. They went and did their mandatory. They went and did their GED, and they graduated from GED, and they got their certificate. And then they started doing college. And at all the prisons, we have real soldado that the inmates or the students can do college with. And as soon as they get done, they can get scholarships to go to Real Salado and start doing college classes through Real Salado. And this is the reason why this ASU program is so important, because a lot of these guys, they don't realize that after they get their GED that they can even attempt to do college. They're like, oh man, GED was so hard. I don't even think that I'm ready to do college yet. But they are. They're ready to do college. And this class lets them know that they are. Like, hey, you're taking a psychology 101 class. You're taking a pre-calculus class. You're taking a creative writing class. This is the same stuff that they teach the ASU students. This is essentially a same class that they teach at ASU. So if you're able to comprehend and understand this class, you have it. You can go and do that higher education. It's amazing. It's amazing that they have those opportunities and the things that allows them to say, hey, I can do this now. All right. Sorry. I get off on tangents.
No.
All right, we're doing a good time. Yes.
Okay, I'd like to thank you for the work you're doing, because it makes my life a lot easier. Allow me to explain. I'm an employment coordinator, and I spend a lot of my time talking to employees. In this economy, it's all about, do you know how to learn? So when our clients come to us, and they've come out of incarceration, and they've got their GED, they now have a certificate that says, we can look. Mm-hmm. And in this economy, that is more important than almost anything else. So, yeah, I'm always happy to see your clients, because we know we've got a fighting chance of getting into front of the right kind of employment.
Absolutely.
So, please don't stop.
Awesome. Thank you.
Would you explain mandatory education?
Yes, you can.
When an inmate comes into the Arizona Department of Corrections, they are mandated to pass an eighth grade literacy test to help with their recidivism rate. So that is just for all inmates before they can be released from the prisons, any type of prison that they come into.
Well, what you didn't say was that was mandated by the legislature.
Yeah, mandated by legislature.
And actually, what you all need to know is that was mandated by the legislature in the late 90s. And they only mandated eighth grade education. They didn't mandate GED. They didn't mandate 12th grade. They said, oh, obviously our inmates need to have an eighth grade education, but not 12th grade.
Right.
So our legislature, not this group, this different group, but in the late 90s, mandated eighth grade education. What the heck is that? You can't say, get a job saying you want pride. You can tell it really still pisses me off.
Initially, it was sixth grade.
Oh, yeah.
And then it's been up since then. And around the country, it's different. Like California, I think, is ninth grade right now.
So then it's 12th grade.
But that's why we've created the high school program.
Yeah.
We're supposed to help out. Because that helps the...
So can we talk to our legislators, please, and say 12th grade?
Yes.
Everybody, right to their legislators.
The picture that you're looking at now is a picture of my classroom. Go back.
There you go. It's right there.
This one?
The other one.
This one?
Yeah.
Okay. As you can see, my classroom is very, very colorful. All the artwork on the walls were painted by STG guys, which is Street Strategic. Security Threat Group. Thank you. So the CO4 in my unit, which is Browning, and I work at a maximum security unit. Arizona does not have a supermax unit. I work at the maximum security unit. And so these inmates are allowed to come in after 3 o'clock, after I leave, and paint. We have come up with pictures that they can paint. So I wanted my classroom to be an inviting conversation piece. So when you come into my classroom, you see these pictures and say, oh, who's that? Who's that? Could you be surprised that the students that come in, they don't know the great philosophers. I wanted a picture of Socrates, Aristotle. I wanted those guys up there because they had no idea who these guys were, great philosophers. So would you go to the next picture,
please? Yes.
Okay. That's part of my classroom there. Now, my classroom has steel desk because my students are handcuffed and ankle cuffed when they come to class. So in the mornings when I come in, I have to get all ankle cuffs for them to be chained to the desk or so they can't leave. That's how my classroom is. Jeremy's classroom is inmates are free to walk around, but not mine because I'm a maximum security unit. I have to have them in the ankle cuffs. And I also wear a Kevlar vest that's just mandated by DOC. The vest does not make my students feel bad because to me, it's all about respect. I respect my students and I expect them to respect me also. And I treat them like human beings. My motto is, I see you as a student first, human being second, and an inmate last. And I always tell them, don't get the three twisted because the teacher in me will always see you as a student. So that's my classroom. Any questions?
Yes, please.
It looks like, well, from this angle, it looks like you have a limited number of desks. So I'm wondering how many students you typically have in a class.
Well, right now I have 3 students because I just teach special ed students.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let me elaborate on that a little bit more. At certain levels of there's policies that are the state legislature have come up with, and in these policies max facilities, such as Roberta's facility, a lot of the policy states that you can only have anyone that's under 22 and in special education still receive special education services. And
if they had a special IEP, which is an individual education plan. If they had one of those on the streets before they came into prison and they are, like Jeremy said, under the age of 22, we have to continue those services until they turn the age of 22. So a lot of my students are youngsters, or well, young guys, who have assaulted either other inmates or assaulted staff, so they come to my unit, come to Browning, and finish out however many years they have been given because of the assault.
I'll get to your question in just 1 second. In other units, the classroom size is 18 per classroom. We have a morning and an afternoon class, so we have 36 per classroom. And depending on the yard, we have several teachers on different yards. The yard that I'm at Central Unit, we have 2 teachers. At North Unit, we have 4 teachers. So expound that 36 by 4. And then the different yards have a number of teachers. We have both mandatory and GED classes at each of the units so that we are trying to accommodate all the students that need to be educated and need to get their education. We're trying to get as many in as possible. Yes, sir. You had a question.
So I was just going to comment on the question. So we teach prison biologic group is teaching the same class of Ms. Norales. And we started the year with 10 students, but now we have 8, so that's the maximum we can have. And the other thing that I want to point out, in one of the previous slides, you can see the back of the room. Here we see the front. That's the side, but here you can see in the back those cupboard-looking things. They're actually enclosures that we used to teach our students when they were inside those kind of things. And that was really awkward. I mean, we still, after an hour or so picking them, you kind of forget that there are any kind of barriers, and again, they become students, but it's a lot better with the setup that we have right now. So there is definitely progress, and things are getting better.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Yeah, the students are chained to these desks, right, by the angle.
Yes, angle.
But they can stand up. So right. Not right. Like,
yes. Dr. Metcalf, and then we'll go to you, sir.
Could you explain the e-capping process, please?
Yes. All right. So we currently are trying to we've implemented a new program over at the Florence Complex, and what this is, and it's a pilot program for the whole we're hoping it for the whole state. But what it is that we are working specifically with a company called Arizona at Work. I don't know if you guys have ever heard of like the one stop shops. Anyone? Yeah, no, yes, no. So we are working with a company called Arizona at Work. It's a department. And what it is that they help with people that are trying to get jobs and get into school that have been down on their luck, basically. And we have a process that we're doing right now with all of our students that we are starting folders for them. We are going through and looking and seeing what kind of it's kind of like a interest profiler that we have them do. And we have them fill out an interest profiler to find out what kind of jobs that they would be interested in. And this is something we do for all of our students. And as they are looking, as they look up and find three jobs, we have them look up and find three jobs that fit all of their interests. And we have them start doing research on those jobs. What kind of pay it is? What are the employment opportunities? Where can you go and get this job? And all these things are all done while they're in class, in with their schoolwork. And as we work through them and have them look through these jobs, we also help them build resumes for these jobs so that they can be able to use this something to be able to get out and go do something that they would be interested in, something that they would be willing to actually, hey, I'm going to give this one a try. I'm going to give this a shot because this is something that, you know, it has been a lot lacking in trying to help these guys to get out and start getting jobs right away. So not only are we trying to educate them in actual like academic areas, but also educate them on how to get jobs and what to do and where to go to be able to get those jobs. Yes, sir. You had a question.
I just wanted to say that's a great program. I think that's an awesome provision. It wasn't available on my prison sentence, but I would enjoy having it. I just wanted to talk a little bit about my experience because I actually used to go to GED. I was at Central Unit for some years in those boxes there. Mm-hmm. And that's how I used to go to my GED program. But at the time, you know, because I got locked up when I was 15. I got out when I was 22 the first time. And I was trapped as an adult. I went through the minors unit. Mm-hmm. But at the time, just from my perspective, I didn't care about my GED because I felt there was I had no future. That's the way I felt because everything around me told me that. And so when I was on the yards and I was on the open yards, like I was on the four yard, it's a hyper-violent environment and you're just concerned about survival and how you're going to navigate through this environment. So you don't really care much about GED either. So, you know, that was my experience and that was also the experience of a lot of people around me, my peers, during that time. But when I went back to prison the second time, that's when I actually got my GED. And the difference was is that I knew that my GED was my stepping stone for me to be able to go to college, and I knew me going to college was going to provide me a future. So I believed that I could have a future. So that was the difference. It took me 2 weeks of studying to not only go get my GED, but score higher than anybody else who would take the GED. At the time that I took it. So, you know, that just that bit of insight I wanted to offer for, you know, when you're dealing with students who are learning, who seem maybe like they're not really interested, that might be a way to get them interested is to help them believe that there's a future, that this actually leads to something.
I appreciate that, and I am so glad that you've come as far as you had. That's phenomenal. I try to do that in my class, and the teacher's assistants that I have, that I get, my TAs, I have them, those are the guys that have gone through the system. and gotten their and have received their GED, and they are usually the, I put those guys in those places for a reason, because they are the ones that give these other guys those that inspiration, and they're the ones that, hey, I've been down, and you know, these are guys that have been down a little bit longer than some of these newer guys coming in, and they're the ones saying, hey, youngster, you need to do this. This is something you need to do. And that's what's wonderful about having these teacher's assistants. We use the other guys that have been on the yard longer to be able to try to motivate these guys to say, this is possible and you can do this. And then on top of it, not only can you do this, but you can move on. And here's a real Salado application, you know, and you can get this done. On top of having Rio Salado, we also have Central Arizona College at all the different facilities that we have. Central Arizona College does all like trade related classes for us. Over at North Unit, they teach HVAC classes. Over at South Unit, they teach welding. Over at East Unit, they teach carpentry. We really try to promote as much as we can a learning environment that will help these guys as much as they can when they get out. And that's the whole purpose of the education department, and it all encompasses the education department. It's the education, CAC, Rio Salado, everything that all comes together, trying to give these students the best opportunity when they get outside. Yes.
Mention something. Well, two things. One is these programs are awesome, and they do provide help and help reduce recidivism for the people who can partake of them. Mm-hmm. But I think it's probably less than 1% of the entire population that has access to these programs. Mm-hmm. You know, I was in the HVAC class in Tucson.
Okay.
And you know, when I first started the class, I was excelling. I was doing really good. But we were also getting to go 2-3 times a week to class. It's a centralized hub. So we had to bus over to it. And at that time, they would take people from all different yards. And so you got to go more often. Then they stopped doing that because they didn't want us communicating with people from other yards. So what would happen was, it would be, you can't complete that class without going to class because everything's testing on boards. So what would happen is, it would be like I would go to school once, and then 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 months would pass. 8 months. It was almost 2 years at one time. They came and got me. I wasn't even in the class anymore. And they came and got me. And they're like, "Yeah, you ready for school?" I'm like, "No."
What? You're like, "What?"
So those types of things they're there. But how many people? What's the actual success rate? How many people are actually graduating this program? And that's, I think, what's important.
Can I have? You want to answer that for me?
Yeah. Last year we were 242 inmates in the system of Arizona receiving certificates, which are transferable to the colleges to go to college. That was just a one time.
At about 4,300?
And our governor, Doug Ducey, is very, very proactive in trying to reduce recidivism rate with our LEAN program. And we have a concept now where we are looking at high-risk inmates, those inmates that have a certain amount of time to be in prison. We're trying to get them into programming quickly so we can prepare them to be productive citizens when they get out. And that's, I really appreciate Governor Ducey for doing that. Yes. Well, I think when they graduate from the CAC classes, do they not get a certificate of some kind?
Mm-hmm.
They do. And our biology class, Dr. Moore, you give our students' biology certificates for of completion. So we always tell them, whatever you do while you're inside the walls, make sure that you can take that and use that skill when you get out. So we try to give them certificates so they can show their employer, you know, this is what I've done. I haven't been just sitting around twiddling my thumbs eating bonbons all day. So we try to, you know, encourage them to take that. And for my students, when I had GED students, I would always encourage them to get their GED so they can make more money on the yards. Because I always tell them, one day you're going to leave this yard and go to an open yard. So if you have your GED, you can work in a bakery, or you can work being maintenance. You can work on the floor crew. You can be a TA to help your teachers and help your other fellow inmates. So that's how I would encourage them to get their GED. Yes, Mr. Long.
I promise a woman. I break my promise. What, to your speaking to your question and dovetailing out of your comments on the governor, I don't know if you're going to state the speech. We're working on different things like the truth of the we're also working on actual, I think, the term is employment units in some prisons, where we are going to. Bring them up to speed into like the 21st century and for some of them. I mean, I'll give you an example. You know, I've been in a prison yard and had a guy come up to me and say, why are you always living? I'm a lot of prisons. And so I said to him, where were you born? And he tells me, no, the street, the house number, where were you born? And I plugged it in and I pulled it up and I said, was it this house? He was like, yeah. And that's just an example of how the world has changed. You know, maybe while somebody has been incarcerated. So we're looking at all those things we're talking about. Things like, we're talking to in these little units that are going to be opening, like working with clothing banks, getting clothes, working with interact with the world, you know, how to make phone calls and ask for new people.
Let me introduce the person that just spoke. Can I introduce you, sir? No? This is that was Tim Lawrence. He is the regional director of education for the Department of Corrections. So
I think we have time for one more question.
One more question.
And that's all we can do, but thank you guys so much.
Yes, go ahead.
I was just gonna ask, so I feel like you guys have been saying that it really gives hope to the students that you guys are teaching. Kind of hearing him say that you didn't go to class for 2 years, like, that almost broke my heart, because it's almost like you're giving them hope and then you're taking it away. And I would imagine that when the kids go through the program and they complete it, they're excited to get out and actually show their skills, and the likelihood for them to return as an offender are less likely. So knowing that, you know, there's still a lot of opportunity to grow from the 4,200 inmates to the 22 that got educations, what is your five-year plan to say, how can we double, triple, quadruple it? How can we get to these half million inmates that are in there and get them education? Wasn't it 242?
242. Mm-hmm. But that's our whole process, and what she was talking about, these students that are they're high, they have the kind of a high probability of recidivism. We're trying to target those inmates first to try to make sure that they get all the programming and all the education they need so they don't come back. And that's what the thing is. And the 5-year program that you're talking about is us working with those one-stop shops and us working in those in helping them get their resumes done and helping them to be able to move on past get through that process. And try to do is get it through many guys as we possibly can. We're currently seeking out a grant even to try to help us to be able to get extra staffing on to be able to help with that transition process of guys once they get out to be able to hand their folders over to Arizona at Work and be able to work with Arizona at Work specifically and track their progress even after they get out. You know, to make sure that, hey, how well is this working? What is this doing for them? Is this being productive? Is it helping them to be able to get those jobs and get those opportunities? I know a lot of guys that when they get out, those opportunities aren't there. And that's why I think your guys' program is wonderful, because it's going to give these guys more opportunities when they get out to be able to be gainfully employed, to be able to do something. Because I've heard stories of guys going out and turning in 50 applications and not getting a single call back because there's that box on that application that says felon. And it's detrimental, honestly, because it doesn't give these guys a second chance. And so this is something that we're trying to, you know, that would be state law that would have to change something like that. But it would be something that would us being able to try to give them everything in their arsenal to be able to use to be able to get a job. That's what our job. That's what our goal is, just to be able to give them all those opportunities.
Well, thank you both so much. We really appreciate you coming in.